Hi everyone, my name is Novia and in daily basis I'm working as a data scientist. So for now I would like to share a bit on stochastic programming. Basically it's like saying how we can Basically, it's like saying how we can incorporate the stochastic concept into inventory models, but most importantly, we can implement this in Python. So moving forward, there are several different concepts that we will go through. In the first point, we will talk about the background of the problem, and then we will move forward on how the current trend can handle this kind of problem, and then I will share a bit on the different perspective from the other side of the world, and then we will enable that concept so that we can handle the uncertainty and how we can implement it in Python. Okay, let's start. So we live in modern world, and basically we see all of the products like everywhere in grocery shopping, every single product, there are lot of different brands, and for us it's very beneficial because if you don't have one brand, then your life still going on. Like toothpaste, there are brand A, and then if brand A die, you can have another brand, brand B, up to brand Z and maybe more. But then in the end of the day, you see that every company wants is the result, it's the profit. We will always talk about how much money that we can earn. And hence, the numerous amount of brand out there can sort of harm the opportunity for the company to earn more money. Because let's say there are 100 competitors. You cannot set the selling price at any level that you want to. So that sort of limit your capability to earn more profit. And then, there are many type of strategy that people want to implement. Like branding, people will say, okay, let's do the branding so we can increase the selling price. But let's moving in a supply chain world where we can sort of more control about the inventory itself. Because by having a better inventory strategy, we can sort of helping the company in building a more sustainable business. There are two different extreme strategy here. First, we can implement lower inventory level, and that would help us with a lower risk during uncertainty, because when the demand is low, you can, let's say, avoid to throw away your remaining goods in the end of the season. And that will be helpful, especially if your goods are having expiry date. But then it comes with a price. You will have a higher cost price, which means that is caused by your inability to leverage your power in money. You do not purchase in bulk, so you don't have that leverage in having a lower material cost. But then, in the other extreme, you can sort of telling your employer, okay, let's have a higher supply, but then you will need a lot of money, but you use your money well because you leverage your money buy more material, and hence you can have a lower material cost, which means you can have a more flexibility in defining your selling price. But then the basic question will be like, is this the only choice that we have now? Like, is there any other solution that we can sort of give to our employer? Okay, so in the next section, we will move forward in the how we can approach this problem into a more mathematical or scientific method. To make it easier, I will give you a use case here. Let's say that we know an auntie in a school cafeteria, and we know this auntie is selling a burger. It's easy, right? And you want to help this auntie. This is a very nice auntie. And then for this auntie, you will help build all the data set and you will observe all the daily data and you say, okay, auntie, I can observe that the number of burgers purchased per day move along linearly according to the number of students attending the class per day. It makes sense. And then you can build this kind of pretty graph and show it to the auntie, even if the auntie doesn't know what it means. And then you can also have this nice distribution. This is a Poisson distribution that shows you how many number of burgers purchased per day. And that can implies how many amount of money that can be earned by the auntie at the end of the day. So what you will do? Of course, machine learning comes to the rescue. It's like the most trending method, like we all talk about it every day. If you find the linearity, you can use linear regression. It's easy. Scikit-learn, import, blah, 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 it's done. And then if you find sort of non-linearity, you can use decision tree. It's even simpler. There is random forest, XGBoost, anything works. And if you are having more money, you can sort of using GPU, TPU, anything, and then you implement PyTorch, TensorFlow. Amazing. Auntie will be surprised. Oh, son, you're so nice. So smart. I don't even know this kind of thing exists. But then let's take a stop there. And then let's see what happened. You see, there is a risk when we are implementing prediction modeling. It's about the uncertainty. Because if there is no uncertainty, I will be the cut, you will be the cut, everyone will be rich. But here, I will give you an illustration. Let's say there is 128 students coming that day, and your prediction model saying that, okay, there will be 33 units of burger will be purchased that day. So the auntie should carry as much as 33 units burger, because if you bring more, auntie will have to throw the remaining of the burger, and if she brings less, then she will earn less money. But apparently, if you let auntie work on her own in the other dimension where you are not exist, auntie doing fine. She just carry 34 units without knowing anything, and she can sell that much amount of burger given the same condition. Your prediction basically help because auntie will not sort of spend more money on the material cost. But then the total revenue will be lower because you see when auntie doesn't have you at all, she can earn as much as 714, more money. The total profit, you can see the difference. From your prediction, maybe PyTorch or XGBoost, it will give you $33. And then if auntie work on her own, she can earn $34. You see the fallacy of having, I'm not saying fallacy, but it's more like saying there is a caveat when you are using prediction model. Because when that uncertainty coming and you are not handling it well, you can even have less money. And maybe it's not enough to pay your GPU. You see? The difference is just $1. You may think, ah, it's small number lah, right? But then just imagine if you are implementing this on a much more big scale, like in a manufacturing where you have to sell millions of goods. Then you will start to think, is there anything that I can do? Understanding all of this, I would like to give you another perspective. I'm not saying that this perspective is better, it's just to enrich you, like there are many other methods other than prediction. And here what I want to introduce is optimization. To make it easier for you to understand the difference between prediction and optimization, I will give you a simple analogy. But I hope you don't forget about the auntie that we are about to help, because I will always refer to that case until the end of the presentation. So in the simple analogy, let's say you are given a task, because Singapore sometimes is quite hot, right? So you want to have, there is a particular room. Let's say this is a room X. And then you want to make sure that you are able to enjoy room X with a comfortable room temperature. as a person that comes from a prediction model background, you will say, okay, I will measure everything about the room. I will measure about the humidity. I will measure about the number of the people who is coming. Because the more crowded, the room will be much hotter. And then you maybe even measure the temperature outside the room. And then you'll put all of the data and then you do prediction. And then one day you use your prediction and say, oh, it's too hot lah, cannot. My prediction says the room will be too hot for me. So I will not enter this room. I will try to find another room with a better humidity, with less people. But then let's take another perspective here. This is a optimization perspective. The one with the air conditioner icon. Here the optimization people will say like, why bother about measuring the humidity and everything else? Just buy the air conditioner lah. And then you will have a particular objective that what you want to achieve. You want to stay in a room that say around 23 degrees Celsius. And then because every air conditioner comes with a remote control, then you just need to click the remote control accordingly so that it switches your ideal temperature. So up to this point, I hope you understand the difference between predictive modeling and optimization. Both of them solving the same problem, but then both of them having a different perspective on how to solve a single problem. So you see, here I would like to say that optimization is a very interesting approach. It's not like a prediction where you want to predict something. It's more like saying, if I want to earn more money, I will try to earn that money no matter what the method is, as long as it's still within my constraint. So starting from this slide, I will change my gears a bit. It will be more mathematically advanced, not that advanced, but it just looks more intimidating. But I hope up to this point you understand the difference between prediction and optimization, right? Cool? Okay. So basically, optimization is a big field. And then there are many subtopics inside. The one that I will show you here is like the easiest one for me to understand. This is linear programming. In every modeling, you should know there is always formulation that will help us to translate whatever things out there into the mathematical things. And then we can use computer to solve the sort of formulation or equation. And here what we have is a simple linear programming formulation. In layman words, what we want to do is we want to try to find x that can minimize or maximize the objective function, which you can see at point one there, given that we do not violate any restriction in 2 and 3. The second part there is the constraint equation. Because if we take to the analogy before, we want to make sure that we buy the air conditioner with your own money, for example, not by stealing. That's the constraint. And then at the point 3, it's like the boundary of the variable. We want to make sure that, for example, every variable is positive, every variable is negative, that kind of thing. Don't worry about the formulation because we are using Python. So this means that we can always like just put the coefficient into the proper format in Python library and then just let Python solve the problem. But this is just to give you an understanding. At least you will have sort of a very little idea on how linear programming looks like. This is a very, very academic example just to make sure you understand more on how we can implement the formulation previously into the actual problem. I will give you like a few seconds maybe, to read the problem and then I will explain to you. You can read now. Okay, all done reading? Okay, so I will explain a bit here, but you get the idea now. There is a company called company XYZ, and company XYZ has a very limited production capacity. And then what we want is to have a best combination of product A and B. Whatever the combination is, we know that one unit of product A produced will give you a profit of $3, and then one unit of product B will give you a profit of $5. Then how to put this into the equation? First, you see the point, the part one, it's the objective function. It's the one that we want to do. What we want? More money. So 3 times unit A plus 5 times product B. 3 and 5 coming from the profit. And then in the second part, it's the constraint. I'm not giving you the detail on the limitation of the constraint because it will take more time, but basically 180, 150, and 300 are the maximum hour capacity that we are imposing in this problem. And then take example C2, it implies that every one unit of B will take 2 hours capacity from machine 2. And it should be limited within the 150 constraint. And then in third part, we have the boundary. We want to make sure that we produce a positive number of product. We cannot sell negative number of product to user, right? And because it's still easy, we just have 2 decision variables. We can have this beautiful graph. You see, C1, the first constraint, is the one, the line that goes up there. And then C2, the second constraint, is the one that horizontal. And the one, C3, it's up there. And the idea is by finding the most optimal corner. It means that whatever corners we pick, we want to make sure that the corner will give us the most highest profit. I give a little asterisk here because the method that I'm introducing you here is a simplex method. It's basically the simplest one that we can learn. There are many other methods out there, the one that can help you to improve the scalability, blah, blah, blah. This is the easiest. So you have the idea on how optimization works, and you sort of get, oh, I see. I think I can implement it somewhere. But then still, it doesn't solve our problem with the auntie. We still have one promise to help the auntie, right? And then, why you think so? Because there is uncertainty in the inventory models. You see, the model is looks nice, but there is still uncertainty within that kind of problem. So how we can handle the uncertainty? First, to be able to handle our problem, we need to understand more about the problem. In our problem, there are 2 different ways of expressing profit. Let's say that purchase is greater or equal to demand. Then we will have to multiply the selling price with the demand as the revenue. And then we will minus it with the material cost, which is coming from cost price multiplied by the number of purchase. But then if the purchase is less than the demand, then we will have to multiply selling price with the number of purchase. And then we minus it with the total material cost. This is the characteristic of our problem. It's getting more complicated. And remember, demand there is still uncertain. So, intuitively speaking, any complicated problem, we should split it into simpler problem. And it's the same with our approach. Mathematically, we can split the problem into 2 parts. In the first stage, we need to make the current decision arbitrarily, like no matter what happened, I want to stock 50 burger, for example. And this is the one that happened in the first stage. And then in the second stage, we need to come up with an additional variable. In this case, we want to have a variable that is related to the number of product B to sell. It implies that like this. Once we set up the number of burger to purchase by the auntie equal to 50, and then let's say the demand is 30, we should take this additional decision variable. For example, because the demand is 30, then we have to sell all of the 30. So this is the additional decision variable that we should take. And to make it more simpler, we can implement discretization in the uncertainty. If you still remember this graph, it looks fancy, but it doesn't really helpful when you are doing your modeling. We can sort of quantify this kind of thing in the left into the things on the right. So what the things in the right saying is like the probability of having 25 burger purchased during that day is around 0.145. And that goes the same with the other possible scenario. So it's more simpler and you can put it nicely in our linear programming equation letter. After several lines of formula derivation, and after the discretization, and after considering all of the possible form of the profit, we can come up with this kind of formulation. Basically, the one who do the formula derivation is not me. You can read many different tutorial or papers on stochastic programming, and I have to upload the material inside my GitHub. But you see the beauty of this formulation? The problem that we have just now is quite complicated. Demand uncertain, and then the profit, there are two forms, and so many things. And then what we do here is just to simplify things. In the objective function, in max z equal to blah, 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 it's just a total profit that is weighted with the probability of scenario that a number of burger to purchase will happen. And then in the subject two, it's the constraint, and it's basically like a common sense constraint. For every scenario to happen, you want to make sure that whatever number you sell, it will not exceed the demand, it will not exceed number of purchase, and it will not exceed maximum purchase. Because maybe like the school cafeteria limit the warehouse for the burger up to 100, for example. And to make it clear, demand S here is the demand under scenario S. We should denote that this kind of simplification is possible because our problem is still simple. It's like the optimal solution that can happen is because we should take any decision regarding the number of burger to sell should be equal to the number of burger we keep in our warehouse. So that gives a much more simpler formulation. Okay. You get through the hardest part, now the easiest part, implementation. So the thing that we have done earlier is like trying to adapt our real world problem into mathematical modeling and make it easier by converting everything into the simplest optimization model possible, which is linear programming. And by having linear programming model itself, we can use many library in Python, but here, if you start to learn optimization, my suggestion is to start with PULP. It's a library in Python that can help us with the optimization problem. Why? You can read the paper. There is a paper related to PULP, but basically it has a non-restrictive licensing and installation is quite easy. And for me, the syntax is much more clearer. And most importantly, it also have interoperability with the number of solvers because there are many other optimization solver out there, and it's like they have their own language, and it's kind of annoying that you have to change your language every time you use different solver. And here it's, you are helped with the interoperability across different solvers like Cplex, Kuropi, and etc. And then the documentation for me is quite useful. But there is a caveat. PULP can only solve linear programming and integer programming. So you may not want to use this kind of thing if your problem is quadratic or maybe polynomial, but in our case, because we are working hard in the simplification of the problem, then we can use PULP as a starting point. First, what we need to do with PULP, we need to define what we want. We want to maximize our profit. That's why we write LP maximize there. And then we want to call our problem as news vendor one. And that's how we come up with the first line. And then in the second part, we define our variable. It's the decision variable that I'm talking all this time, the one that comes from the two stage. X is the number of burger that we want Auntie to purchase as a stock. And then second is the additional variable, which is the number of burger to sell as you see how the demand is realized in the real world. And then the next part is like quite easy. You just need to put any the variable and the number according to the formulation that we have defined earlier. It may look complicated, but if you look at it like quite meticulously, you can see that there are a lot of similarity between this one and the formulation that we have discussed earlier. And in the end, you do the M dot solve. This one can solve your problem. Like the PULP library will try to find the best solution for you. Extraction, it's like this, just dot name dot var value. It's easy. It's a no-brainer. And then as you click enter, you can earn this like the optimal solution. You can come to the auntie and say, Auntie, you should buy around 23 burgers because PULP told me so. But you see the idea. X is the output, it's 23 burger. And Z, if you remember, is our additional variable. It's the decision that we take when we know what is the demand realized. And then the objective, it comes from the total profit that is weighted according to the probability of the scenario to happen. Now, to make it look interesting, I do help you with a graph here. I try like several different action according to the, if you see in the x-axis, there is possible action to happen, and then see the total weighted profit according to the data set that I have provided to you in the GitHub link. But basically, as you see, the function here is keep dropping. Like it's starting high when you stock around 20 burgers, and then it keeps dropping down when you take an action of 33 burgers. And as you can observe, the most optimal solution is when you purchase 23 units of burger. Actually, up to this point, you should realize something interesting. If you think that you work with a very similar range, right, and you are working with a predictive modeling, in some sense, usually predictive modeling coming with the average of everything, and it means that the optimal solution should come in the middle, not something that is in the left side or in the right side. But here, what happened is because in the stochastic programming, selling costs and the profit are taken into account, we can sort of get the idea that the auntie doesn't need to stock a lot of burger because the probability of having higher demand is low, and then you want to sort of protect auntie from that kind of uncertainty. But then remember that all this time, what I'm talking about, I'm still using the Y variable, which is the historical demand of the burger, nothing else. I'm still not using the independent variable that comes from the number of students attending the class. What you can do next is like, you can do the predictive modeling, of course, but then instead of coming up with a single prediction, you can come up with a distribution of prediction. And that can help the stochastic programming to narrow the weighted of the probability. And this can be done with various methods like simple bootstrapping, Bayesian regression, or even you can even use the confident interval if you want to. The one that I'm uploading in the GitHub is the one with using simple bootstrapping just to make things easier. You see, here is the result of implementing the distribution of prediction into the stochastic programming. I'm coming back again to the example from the auntie, and by having the student of attending the classes around 128, simple bootstrapping will give us a probability of around 0.13 for the 30 units of burger, and then a probability of 0.87 for 34 units of burger. To make things more interesting here, I try two different selling price. You see, in the left side, the selling price is only $21, and the stochastic programming gives us the most optimal solution to be having a stock of 33 units of burger. And then in the right side, we have another optimal solution, which is 34 units of burger. And you can see here how this subtle difference can give us different answer on what is optimal, what is not optimal. Because in the left side, the selling price is 21. It means our profit is just $1. And it's not worth to take the risk. Like if you carry too much, then you will most likely you will throw the things away and you will lose your profit instead. But then if you have more margin and it means more money, then you have that kind of flexibility to afford your uncertainty, and then you can get more profit by just taking into account this kind of uncertainty and the profit, which is, I think, giving a fresh idea on how things that we have done so far with the prediction modeling. In prediction modeling, no matter what is the profit, selling cost, total cost, all matters is the precision, accuracy, and that's it. So I think, for me, this kind of approach is more pragmatic in some sense, but it helps my employer get more money. So let's get through about what we have learned so far. In the beginning, we learned about the difference between prediction modeling and optimization. Both are good in their own ways. And then we also learned about the basic concept of linear programming. And then we also learn one or two things about how to handle optimization under uncertainty and how to simplify those kind of optimization problem with discretization, and then also the implementation of the deterministic equivalent formulation. And next, if you have time, you can take a look at my GitHub. I have uploaded the necessary material there, and including the reading material, the papers that I'm referring to. It's basically a tutorial, not paper, but anyway. And if you don't have enough time, then you can just click in this link, because they are providing the tutorial and everything. Okay, that's all, and that's my contact details. If there is any question, I would like to let you know. Okay. Sure.
The technique you used for basically removing the uncertainty to make it a discrete model, sorry, a deterministic model?
Oh, I'm using
or only for linear programs?
There are many methods available there, but the one that I'm uploading in the GitHub is the simplest one. I'm using clustering, because it's just like less than 15. So I just make it easy and then find up with the probability, just counting the things. But you can try like the fancier one, you can use Wasserstein something, and then you can use moment generation, blah, blah, blah. Okay, any other question? That's all.
Thank you.